with us, and of course, wonderful to have the panel here. We are very lucky that we were able to get these very busy people together. I've been given biodata to announce. I don't think I need to do that. Everybody knows who these gentlemen are. Waqar is now perhaps writing some of the best columns I've seen on the state of the economy and what to expect from what's going on right now. And I think it's really wonderful, Waqar, that you are doing that. It's great public service. Hafiz is doing some of the best speaking on the current state of affairs, and it's really wonderful to have him with us. Naveed is doing some of the best thinking on what's going on these days, because he's on the Monetary Policy Committee. So he's directly involved in the macroeconomic framework. And I'm doing some of the best coordinating today because I have such a fantastic panel. Pakistan's macro problem is actually not a very complex problem. Of all the macro crises that one sees in the world, this is not a particularly complex. Complex problem us waqt hota hai jab private sector involved ho jata. When there's a lot of private sector borrowing from the banking sector, then the banks get involved. And resolving bank liabilities is a major issue. So in that sense, we are fortunate. It's not a, it's really a governance crisis. It's a government crisis. And which is why it gets easily fixed. We've seen this being fixed at least 3 times in the last 10 years. Musharraf got some of the biggest fiscal space that you could imagine because of debt forgiveness. And he left the seat with an empty kitty, because they went on an expenditure spree towards the end of the government, and the elected government, People's Party government, inherited an empty kitty. People's Party went to the IMF, they put in a stabilization program, they achieved stabilization, not the structural reform part of it. Then they started the expenditures, and when they left, empty kitty for the next government. Muslim League government did exactly the same thing. Went to the IMF, stabilization, when the expenditure part came, again, left an empty kitty for the new government that's come in. So it's a recurrent problem, yet it's not a complex problem because it's only the state that needs to be managed. It's not the private sector. So what I'm going to expect from today's discussion is that we shed light on 3 kinds of issues. One is, had it become absolutely necessary for us to go to the IMF, given that in the past engagements with the IMF, 3 of them in the last 10 years, is it obvious that IMF is again the solution at this current stage of the problem? So let's have a round of discussion on that. The next part of the discussion will be the first government instrument that has been revealed to the public is the budget for implementing the IMF program, implementing the stabilization component of the IMF program. So let's have a round of discussion on whether it makes sense. Will it achieve stabilization? And will it achieve stabilization in any way which is tougher than on the previous 3 occasions? Because, you know, if you read the print media, if you listen to the TV channels, one gets the impression that all hell has broken loose. And it turns out, as Waqar wrote in one of his columns, this is not the first time, and it's not the hardest budget that we've seen. So let's have some discussion on that. And the third part of the discussion will be, Do we see in any evidence, both in the way the budget has been structured and also in some of the early exposures of government's own intentions, that this will indeed be the last IMF program? So let's have these three broad aspects of this discussion. And with that, let me open up by first inviting Hafiz to tell us whether, given that we've gone through this three times before, is it obvious that we should have gone to the fund again?
Fancy macroeconometric model of with 46 equations, and I was going to throw it at you, but I will not do that anymore. I'm so happy that we can have more communication. Why IMF? You see, the problem, it seems to me, is that we have reached a stage where the external financing requirements of this country have reached, if I may use the word, astronomical proportions. And perhaps clearly, where is, given the fact that our exports have tended to show little or no growth, imports have grown very fast. Reasons, of course, we all can discuss. The point is that this year, even after some degree of adjustment in the current account deficit, which will probably come down from about $20 billion to close to about $14 billion or so, maybe slightly more, but 14 is a safe bet. In that case, if we do nothing, or if you don't have any access to any international financing, then you start with a current account deficit of $14 billion. And the thing which is most worrying is the peaking and the extraordinarily rapid growth of debt repayment. Interestingly, a few years ago, a very large part of our external financing requirement used to be the deficit on the current account. Now we are reaching a stage where very soon the debt repayment will become the largest single liability for us. And the reason for that is over the last 5 or 6 years, we have been going in increasingly for commercial borrowings from the international banking system. We have floated bonds, 5-year maturity, 10-year maturity. And the overall volume of debt has also increased rapidly. So the end result is, you have a situation where if you include our obligations of honoring the private debt of also repayment, we are very close to having to service debt the coming year to the tune of about $12 billion. So you have a situation where if you do nothing about the current account deficit, and the other thing about this is that current account deficit hopefully is clearly amenable to policy. But the debt liability is not, in the sense that you have already got the debt rescheduling, as you referred to, the Paris rescheduling, and in fact, now we're back to the normal repayments. The very important thing is I've given you a conservative figure of $12 billion. Were you to have to honor your obligations with respect to the deposits in the central bank, which are basically the deposits given to us on a short-term basis by Saudi Arabia, by United Arab Emirates, and more recently also by China. That alone adds up to almost $7 billion or more. So this is 12 plus 7. Now, if you have to honor this kind of debt repayment, which is given as of now, plus a high current account deficit, how will you finance this gap? Were you to even drive your current account deficit to zero, you would still have to honor your debt repayment obligations. So historically, whenever we have had a difficult situation, in fact, in some ways, the situation in the People's Party time in 2008, it was predominantly the current account deficit, not the debt repayment. In the Nawaz Sharif period, 13, it was not the current account deficit. It was the due debt repayment, in fact, to the IMF, not to many others. This time, the compulsion is driven by both a huge current account deficit, which even after reduction will remain somewhere in between 6 to 10, depending upon the intensity of your adjustment policies, and your debt obligations, which at the minimum are 12, and if you can't roll over, 17. So now you have to go begging to the world. And that is also what justifies a very tough IMF program.
Right. Okay. So this is a very nice opening statement by Hafiz on why we need to go to the fund. Waqar, your take on that? Again, let's keep it brief so that...
Sure. Rahman, I think I totally agree with what Pasha Saab has said. If I were to add why this has been brought about, this is the final outcome that he's saying. In terms of what choices have led to this outcome is essentially on the fiscal side. And the recurring pattern, in fact, there are other issues also. If time permits, maybe we can delve into that also. But effectively, what happens, and you had mentioned that some stability or stabilization was done in the first 3 years of Noon and government. Subsequently, they again opened up the floodgates. The fiscal deficit, which was around 4.3, jumped to 5.8 and then 6.6. This year, it is 7.6. So my thesis is that these are the choices. And much of this excess demand that is generated on the fiscal side demands foreign spending. And you are importing LNG, you are importing energy in general, and then you have other needs which are considered very essential, so you need foreign exchange for those things as well. I don't think private sector adds much to they also earn, so the export earnings belong to the private sector. So on a net basis, they are not the one who burden our external account. It's the government. So if you will follow this path, go that far, and imagine when they did some in the last 11 months or so, sporadic adjustments of interest rates and the exchange rate, despite that you have this outcome that we have a 7.6% deficit, nearly 3,000 billion rupees of extra spending. So this is really Achilles' heel for Pakistan's economy. So the IMF program, whenever it's there, and you know, in some ways it also shows you that your own ability to self-restrain is just not there. It is the fund's presence that unfortunately gives you the necessary discipline and monitor to do the right things. So viewed in this perspective, the fund program not only was inevitable, but we have delayed it. And we have delayed it to a point. In fact, the fund program had become due. My definition of when a fund program is needed, when your reserves start falling. And that process started early 2017. Yes. But then it accelerated during Miftah and Abbasi Saad's tenures. Yes. And they recklessly borrowed also during those periods. Those commercial loans that you spoke about, those were essentially borrowed at that time. So with such amount of excess demand, and your inability that you can self-restrain, then an outsider is needed. Because after a while, the foreign funding is not available. Nobody is ready to lend you. So, I mean, the small support friends provided to you, carried you for a few months, you have seen. The reserves are down. Just the number was out, $7 billion. And $7 billion are the ones who says, and Pasha Saab just mentioned, are the deposits in the state bank, only counting the new ones. But there are previous ones also. So, in fact, the deposit that central bank has to, on demand, and their bond limit very soon. So those are larger than the $7 billion. So effectively, we are out of reserves. So the point I'm making is that it's the fiscal side, very menacingly, in some ways, it is the external side which is a check on you. If somebody is ready to keep giving you money, you would not stop. I mean, the people, look, I mean, we are people, and I have seen, I mean, so many governments. When you are in government, you think that you can order any amount of spending. And how it is financed is, these people don't know. So I stop here.
Thank you, Bakar. One of the things that frustrates me when I watch TV programs is when the previous government, the outgoing government, representatives come on TV and say, ki is hukumat ne diwaliya nikal diya. And I think part of the reason why they can make these statements is because they delayed going to the IMF. Had they gone to the IMF in September, it would have been obvious where the problem lay, how the problem arose. This dithering of the last 6 or 7 months means that the ball has been put squarely in their lap, and they are unable to deal with the media onslaught, saying that all the problems have been caused by this government. Naved, you've been fairly close to discussions, being a member of the Economic Advisory Council. Is it obvious to you that the fund program should have happened a lot earlier?
Well, I let me apologize to you. I think that you have set the subject, which is not what way I would have addressed it. I think it's a trivial question whether we should have gone to the IMF or not. I think, as has been mentioned, there was no choice. We thought, some people thought, we disagreed, some people thought we could get better terms, we could delay it by getting money from friends. We've used up all that money, plus the Chinese money, $9.2 billion, our reserves today are less than that. So it is really a no-brainer. So if that's what we want to talk about, I don't know. I thought the more interesting question was...
Hang on, let me finish. There are three parts to this discussion.
Let me finish, then you can continue with yours. I thought the more interesting question was, why do we have to go back to the IMF again and again and again? Okay. Two, why is Pakistan being left behind our neighbors by a huge amount? Why are India and Bangladesh growing so much faster than us that their per capita income of Bangladesh crossed Pakistan this year? Why is that the case? And the third question would have been, is the current IMF program, the budget, and the policies that seem to be coming out at the moment going to solve this problem? I think that would have been my take on it. And so I'll come into it whenever you request me. But on this issue, whether we go to the IMF or not, I have nothing to say.
Okay. Well, I thought you had plenty to say, and you've been saying it. No need to be shy today in front of this audience.
No, I said we had no choice.
Because there's a large number of economists who come on television even today, people who were running the Ministry of Finance, people who had important say in the Ministry of Finance, a large number of opinion makers who even today say that we should have not gone to the IMF. And I think the inevitability of turning to the IMF, I think, is something that people need to understand. And there is an audience that I think would appreciate some light being shed on that. So let's move to the next part of the discussion, which is, if the IMF program's objective is to stabilize the economy, the biggest instrument the government has to achieve that is the budget. Because since it's largely a fiscal problem, the budget states what the government's revenues are and what the government's expenditures are. Is this budget indicative of that instrument being used effectively?
A
Okay, now, let me tell you a few things which are perhaps not immediately obvious or mentioned in the media. And I've spent the better part of my life looking at public finance numbers. One of my brightest students, Bakhar, has also done a very good job. The fiscal deficit is expected to close this year. The official government number is 7.2% of the GDP. And I noticed that Bakhar mentioned 7.6.
Now you still have access to revised numbers?
No, this is the revised estimate.
But the budget is a revised estimate.
So yeah, these are 2 months to go. Yeah, no, but the revised estimate is 7.2.
Yes,
and we started the year with a target of 4.9% of the GDP. So you see the extent to which we tend to spill over in the absence of any modicum of fiscal discipline. I mean, spill over. Now, the interesting thing is that those of us who know these numbers and have studied them for years, every year, including the time when he was finance secretary, the revised estimate tends to be much less than the actual outcome through fiscal operations. For example, in 2016-17, the difference was as much as 2 percentage points of the GDP. Now, one of my students is working on this these days. Our estimate is that by the time this year comes to an end, the actual estimate of the deficit is going to be close to 8.2% of the GDP. This is the highest deficit for a very, very long time. The last time we had an 8% deficit was in 2000, if you remember, 12-13, when we went in for retiring some of the circular debt. This is the highest. Now, I have some other revelation for you. For some very subtle reason, the IMF has stopped focusing on the overall fiscal deficit and instead come up with a new measure, which is called the primary deficit. The primary deficit is the total revenue minus non-debt servicing related expenditure. So the budget that has been framed is tailored towards achieving a reduction in the primary deficit to 0.6% of the GDP. And if it stands eventually at 8.42 this year, we are currently operating at about 3% of the GDP as the primary deficit. So they're expecting in 1 year a reduction in the primary deficit from 3% of the GDP to 0.6% of the GDP. Let me assure you that this has never been done before. It is indeed a very ambitious target. Now, the problem here is that by shifting our emphasis to the primary deficit, we are not realizing that the stabilization that we should be attempting on should be focusing on the overall deficit. In fact, the government says, and these are the official numbers, that this year's deficit is going to be 7.2 and next year is going to be 7.1. So where is the adjustment? Where is the stabilization? And let me warn you in advance, based on about 30 to 40 years of research, that I'd be pleasantly surprised, very pleasantly surprised, if the fiscal deficit next year is below 9% of the GDP. And the reason for that is the runaway growth in debt servicing. In 2017-18, it was $1,500 billion. This year, it's going to close at slightly over ₹2,000 billion. And next year, we are targeting at ₹2,900 billion. In 2 years, the debt servicing is going up from 1,500 to 2,900. And let me tell you, this is not because of the growth in the volume of debt only. About 45% of this is due to this extraordinary rapid increase in interest rates. So there is no stabilization in this budget, I'm sorry to say. And we will end up in a situation where probably next year's outcome is going to be even worse, because with all due respects, I cannot see Pakistan's revenues growing at 40% at a time when the economy will be growing at less than 3%. So there is, this budget is a non-starter from the beginning. I'm using strong words, but this is based on experience as well as research.
Yeah. Waqar, your views on the budget from what I've read are somewhat different.
थोड़ी सी जैसे कहते हैं
और बेशक उर्दू में बोले
But he doesn't remember that I bailed him out once from a very difficult situation. Yeah. I hope he remembers that.
Yes. And then when you say, whatever you say, keep that in mind.
Keep that in mind.
اچھا تو میں ذرا سا آپ نے جو ہے اجازت بھی دے دی کہ میں تھوڑی سی بات اردو میں بھی کر لوں میں ذرا سا اختلاف کر رہا ہوں پہلے یہ دیکھ لیں کہ یہ بہت اہم بات ہے کہ پرائمری ڈیفیسٹ کبھی بھی فوکس نہیں رہا اور پہلی مرتبہ آئی ایم ایف نے پرائمری ڈیفیسٹ کو فوکس بنایا ہے اچھا ایک بات تو یہ بڑی اہم ہے آپ نے سر 3% کہا ہے اس وقت تو بمشکل 2% آ رہا ہے پرائمری ڈیفیسٹ ریوائز نمبرز میں ٹھیک ہے جی
بٹ ہوگا 3
اچھا سر دیکھیے ذرا سا میں عرض کروں کہ اگر اگر وہ زیادہ بھی ہوتا ہے نا تو وہ انٹرسٹ پیمنٹ کے اکاؤنٹ میں زیادہ ہوگا نان انٹرسٹ پیمنٹ میں زیادہ ایکسپینڈیچر کا امکان نہیں ہے تو لہٰذا یہ 2.2 لاسٹ ایئر تھا چلیں یہ تو مطلب جلدی معلوم ہو جائے گا
میں نے بتا دیتا ہوں آپ کو ڈیفینس ایکسپینڈیچر ہیز بین گروسلی انڈرسٹیٹڈ ہمارے آرمی کو آپ شکریہ ادا کریں کہ اکارڈنگ ٹو دا ریوائزڈ ایسٹیمیٹس آخری کوارٹر میں ہماری آرمی نے اپنے خرچے کو 11% کم کر دیا ہے اللہ تیرا شکر ہے دس از اے ونڈرفل آرمی سو آئی ایم افریڈ دیٹ نمبر آف ریوائزڈ ایسٹیمیٹ از گروسلی آن دا لو سائڈ ریونیوز آر شون ایٹ 4,150 آلموسٹ
وہ بھی کم
ہوں گے
بالکل
اور تیسری طرف جو آپ نے جو سرپلس بتایا ہے آپ کے پروونسز کا وہ ڈیفیسٹ میں تو لہٰذا اٹس ناٹ ڈیو ٹو ہائر انٹرسٹ پیمنٹس انٹرسٹ پیمنٹس ور اینٹیسپیٹڈ ہاں ہاں اب سوال یہ پیدا ہوتا ہے کرنے دیں بالکل کرنے دیں
پھر ہم واپس آ جائیں
تو پہلے آئی تھنک وی مسٹ ریکگنائز دیٹ the focus on primary deficit is because if you look at last 3 years primary deficit was 0.3% this is 2016-17 then it jumped to 1.6 then it jumped to 2.2 now the revised estimates is 2 I'm taking it at 2.2 so from 2.2 in the first year bringing it down to 0.6 is a significant fiscal adjustment. The fiscal adjustment is there, but you have changed the priority that rather than these expenditures, I will cut those expenditures. We all know, those of us who have done debt dynamics, that primary deficit is the criteria to judge whether the debt accumulation path is explosive or not. So if we turn primary deficit into positive, which would be the second year of the program, third year of the program, then it means that we are on a stable path of debt accumulation. So it will take a while. The debt burden will be with us. But I think this refocusing is a sensible thing that has been done. Alternatively, I also tell you, even if we take it as the revised number, IMF would have accepted that 7.2 is an overall, you would not have brought, the adjustment would have required 2.2% adjustment. Now 2.2% adjustment would have been significantly more than 1.4, which is at the moment. Well, that's one thing. Let me finish this thing that this is a stability criteria. If it happens, then we are on a stable path. But would stability be achieved? And, you know, particularly we were just talking, the governor in his first press conference, like the prime minister, he also announced that we have stabilized. So we were wondering, ki bhai abhi to khel shuru bhi nahi hua, toss bhi nahi hua, aap matlab pehle se natije ka elan kar rahe hain. Dekhiye, ye jo stability budget is, in my judgment, a reasonable attempt. And it has laid the foundation or blueprint to whether you will be able to deliver it. I think this is, and I am not the one who will say, nahi ye kar hi nahi sakte. ठीक है ना, हमारे में बहुत से लोगों का ये अंदाज होता है कहने का. मैं तो हुस्न ज़न रखते हुए ये ख्याल करूँगा कि नहीं ये करेंगे, दे विल गो ऑल आउट. बट आई टेल यू, डूइंग एन IMF प्रोग्राम एंड लकीली और अनलकीली आई हैव डन सो मेनी in the 25 years
all,
that
all
I...
All three of the previous...
Nee, from the time that, I mean, after Pasha Sahab had left, I mean, mujhe mauka nahi mila inke saath karne ka. Lekin uske baad sare programon mein, yani Moin Qureshi wala program bhi jo hai, Shahid Hasan Khan bhi yahan baithe hain, mashallah, Mikal ke saath hum logon ne jo hai wo kiya. So, and I, dekhe, I mean, doing an IMF program and IMF experience for any person having some national respect and care for the honor of the country, it is an atrocious experience. I mean, you sit across and you hear small things and you face unreasonable attitudes also and downright humiliation also. So, I mean, it would be a formidable thing, and there would be no concessions. You have to perform. So whether that performance will come, look, even for this much adjustment, the tax adjustment looked like Herculean, Himalayan, pahad khada hua hai jisko aapne achieve karna hai. Main samajhta hu ye bhi doable hai, agar hum ab third round ke andar jo hai na, is par bhi discuss kar lenge ki kis tarike se ye doable hai. अच्छा, दूसरी तरफ जो है ये सिर्फ बजट, आपने सही कहा एजाज, लेकिन देखें दो और एक्शंस हो रहे हैं जो स्टेट बैंक साइड पे है. द इंटरेस्ट रेट एक्शन हुआ, फिर एक्सचेंज रेट के एडजस्टमेंट्स हुए, और ये जो अभी हुआ है, अब देखिए 141 से 157 के ऊपर आप गए, इट्स ऑल पार्ट ऑफ प्रायर एक्शंस. सिमिलरली 150 बेसिस पॉइंट, दैट्स पार्ट ऑफ द प्रायर एक्शन. सो इट इज़ अ वेरी, आई मीन, and it had to be a difficult, painful program. But the pain has just started. You have to carry it for 3 years. Every quarter, you will be judged in a very serious assessment of every single thing that is written in that MEFP and the huge projections that are there. So right. I stop here.
Thank you, Vukar. So we've had two views on this question of whether the budget is really, is a credible instrument for achieving the stabilization program of the fund. Hafiz Pasha Saab's view is that perhaps not, because the budget is focused on the primary deficit, but the overall deficit is running away, and therefore he doesn't see stabilization, whereas Waqar Masood has said that primary deficit is the right prism by which one looks at this instrument, and it's tough, but it's doable. Question is, will the government be willing to do the tough things that are needed? Naveed?
Yeah, I think I fully agree with what Waqar Saab has said. Okay, when the IMF program requires you to raise the interest rates and to change, what you call depreciate the currency, then you have no control over by how much your debt servicing is going up. So therefore, to take the full fiscal deficit and try to figure work with that, it becomes quite a meaningless exercise. So what you have to see, that is why primary deficit, which excludes debt servicing, becomes the relevant one. That is the true adjustment. And as Waqar Saab mentioned, it also has certain basis. If you can get to a positive, you get a primary surplus, then the debt dynamic becomes positive, and you are out. So that is why it makes a lot of sense to focus on it. But I think in this budget there's another issue which I would have liked to focus on, and with your permission I would just make one statement. The problem in this country is that the entire incidence of taxation, as you presented in our conference, 70% of the tax incidence happens to be on industry and the organized sector. With the result that there's not a level playing field. Investment in industry, investment in productive sectors is at a huge disadvantage relative to the rest of the economy. And that is the reason why we are suffering. Because we are not getting enough investment into these sectors, that's why we're falling behind other countries. And that is why we are not exporting. What this budget tries to do is to bring everybody into the tax net. Whether they're successful or not, that will be to be seen, but they have are trying to do that. And I saw this, I'll just make one other, I just saw this in the Business Recorder. They're going at it very cleverly. What this Business Recorder says, that the entire assets of non-filers will be available to the non-filers on the FBR website from tomorrow. So if you have any doubts about what we know you own, you please get on that website and check it out. In other words, what they're saying, after you look at it, if you have any sense, you will take the amnesty and become a tax filer. I think if they succeed, even partially, in bringing in all these retail sector, the wholesale sector, the branded road sector, the haul road sector, the real estate sector into the tax net, then you will see prices and speculation in property will not remain such a profitable deal, and therefore people will not building apartment houses here and malls elsewhere. They will be investing in their existing industries too, because they will be the profitable thing. So I think what the budget is trying to do, besides dealing with this imbalance, the fiscal imbalance, which is a necessary short-term thing, is to change the structural parameters within the economy. And if they're successful, this can have a huge impact on the future direction of the economy. But that if they are successful is a huge question mark.
So Naved has already beginning to touch on the third aspect of the discussion, which is really about structural reform. So my question was, is the budget a credible instrument as evidence of government stabilization efforts? We had views on that. Naved has opened up the discussion to say, is the budget also addressing the third question, which is this going to be the last fund program? Because remember, there are two reasons that make us go to the fund program, and they are deeply interlinked. It starts off with the fiscal deficit. It starts off with government spending far more than it gets in revenue. That very quickly translates the simple macroeconomic accounting. It translates into a current account deficit. Right? The government tries to manage the current account deficit by intervening in the exchange rate market, by intervening in the tax structure, by beginning to tax imports. That worsens the current account deficit in the long term, makes our exporters less competitive in the international market. So the current account deficit and the fiscal deficits are two sides of the same coin. What evidence do we see in this budget that would give us some hope that the current account deficit and the fiscal deficit are being addressed in the longer term also? So it's not just a one-shot issue. It's not just that we will achieve 2 years stabilization and then we'll go on a big spending binge and back to the IMF program. What gives us comfort the budget and other utterances of the government and other work that's going on in the government, that we are finally making a departure from that awful, vicious cycle. Hafiz.
Let me start by just trying to say that, you know, to the extent that the primary deficit is important, it is indeed one part of the equation which determines the evolution of debt. The second part is sometimes referred to as the debt to GDP ratio multiplied by the real interest rate minus the growth rate. And with all due respects, if the real interest rate goes up to positive to such an extent, the debt accumulation path becomes very rapid, even if your primary deficit disappears. So you're focusing only on one part of that equation. So the end result is that we will end up with a situation where the debt dynamics will go against us if the total deficit increases, as I suspect it will. Now, what are the structural reforms, if any, that we are seeing in this budget? The first, let me say very, very carefully that to me, perhaps the single most important structural adjustment is the realization by our armed forces that they have to cut back on their expenditures. And this is worth clapping for, in fact. I would say well done.
If you believe it.
I do believe it. The only problem is that for the first time, and he's been finance secretary, I've also dabbled in finance, first time in the history of Pakistan, I'm pleased to report to you that the government has explicitly provided for a contingency in the current budget of 112 billion rupees, maybe for what you're saying. But we have to take the word today. Normally, we don't provide for contingencies explicitly. That's, to me, a structural reform. And the fact is that your current expenditure is going up as a whole by over 30%. And if the defense expenditure had not been stabilized or controlled, it would have gone up by something like 35 to 40%. So this, to me, is a major structural reform, and I hope that this can be sustained. The other point of which Ejaz has made about the broadening of the tax base through mechanisms for detection of evasion, as long as this does not lead to a loss of confidence, as long as it does not lead to harassment, and as long as it does not lead to more corruption in the system by our erstwhile FBR officers with all this discretionary power available to them, yes, we do not want to see a situation where these efforts lead to a retreat by business and industry. Our agents of growth have to be protected. The third area where I do see a structural reform, maybe in the direction we might not see from a viewpoint of stabilization, but certainly I see a more concern in this budget for the poor. Historically, since the People's Party period, we have had a Benazir income support program. Now we also have an ASAS program, and it's been very skillfully camouflaged in the budget. It's no longer being shown in development spending. We're now calling all these expenditures social protection and current expenditure. What is the jump? If you add up the two programs and some other smaller programs, we are approaching 400 billion rupees as the size of our social protection programs. Aap baat kar le agar aap chahe to.
Sorry.
Achha. We are now approaching a level of social protection which is 400 billion in the budget. Last year, it was hardly 130 billion. So this government is planning to triple its interventions to tackle poverty and unemployment. So this is another positive indication. Where I see some negative indications, if I may be allowed to quickly say so, is the enormous growth in non-defense, non-debt servicing spending. Do you know grants and subsidies are targeted to grow by 74% next year? 74%, let me repeat. We will have to exercise. And on the one hand, we've been told that the IMF is against subsidies and all that, but on the other hand, in reality, in the budget, subsidies and grants are being increased by 74%. There is a need for economy in that. The second structural reform which is missing is economy in civil administration at the federal level. There, I'm afraid, they've, you know, very nicely said 473 down to 470 or so. And quietly, they have kept a provision for pay and pension increase of 64 billion rupees. So it actually will go up by about 20%. The federal government is far too big. 42 divisions. Now, I'm not talking about the army divisions. There are fewer, thank God. We are talking about 42 divisions and 200 or more autonomous bodies are attached to departments. This is a monolithic setup, especially after the 18th Amendment. Operating costs, if you include the non-salary costs, last year were close to 850 billion, and this year are approaching 1,000 billion. We have to economize on this. That structural reform is missing. And finally, the broad basing. Interestingly, one would have thought that the larger part of the revenue incrementally of FBR would be coming from income tax. But that's the real direction. Out of the roughly 1,500 billion that we are planning to increase the revenues by, 70% are continued to be from indirect taxes and 30% from direct taxes. And within direct taxes, about, my estimate is that, and this is a positive effort, about 20% of the incremental revenues will come from new taxpayers like traders and possibly the small-scale sector and so on. But quite frankly, there is still a lot more to be done to broaden the tax base. But there is a step forward in this.
Okay, so Vakar, I think we've had a deep dive in on the revenue side from a fees. So unless there's something, you know, really you want to point out to be significantly different from what a fees has said, that's great. It'd be good to have some focus on the other side of the coin, which is on the trade account. Is there evidence in the current budget to reflect that that aspect of structural reform is also being addressed?
Okay, I'll come to that, but let me just first say that I don't have to add anything, and in fact, I totally endorse what Pasha Saab has said on structural reforms. But if I recall, you had wanted to know, is this the last time of program? Is this the time that I can reflect on that
absolutely,
also?
Absolutely, right?
So, first of all, I think it was Asad Umar's refrain that, okay, even if we are going, so this will be the last time. So, presently, there isn't any such declaration that this is the last time we are going there. But people still ask this question. And frankly, that takes us back to precisely why we go there. Now, if we can kick that habit, we surely will not go there. But we go to rehab only when nothing is left for us and we are sort of thrown into rehab. And as soon as we are back and slightly healthier, we go back. So I think that really will determine. And am I hopeful that anything on that account will happen, that we will kick our habits and we will have fiscal discipline and begin to live a life of austerity and allowing the growth to take place, be helpful to the creation of growth and wealth in the economy? Well, you know, there I feel a bit pessimistic, although I'm not, it doesn't mean that I am given to that, but the scenario is not very inspiring. There is so much political divide, and it is not just divide, it is downright confrontation, and people are ready to not care, as happens under such occasions, what are the consequences of their actions, and they would rather think that their position is what should win the day. This political temperature would be most harmful to the government itself, more than to the political opponents, because you need, as we have just discussed, this program requires a great deal of discipline, sincerity, seriousness, and you don't want your attentions to be frittering away in different directions. So that would also contribute, or is the reason why I'm feeling this thing. The governance in general. I also tell you one interesting thing, which may be slightly isolated. When we did a small stabilization, it was all because of the provinces agreeing to give surplus, which is only a device to temporarily suspend the revenues that have come, that have been transferred to provinces, and they say that, okay, we are not going to spend them. The even this budget, this adjustment, they are 1% of GDP is provided as provincial surplus. So effectively, and as soon as the program will be over, even during the program, at least once they will default on that thing. But soon after, this is a very fundamental problem in our revenue sharing arrangements. We are effectively, and let me just give you a number. Only 32% of all revenues were transferred to provinces in 2009-2010, the year the award came into being. Today, 47-48% of revenues are transferred to the provinces. The, as he has mentioned, 42 divisions, etc. The federal government has not contracted by the amount that was envisaged at the time when so much resources were transferred over there, with the result that you transfer revenues, but you borrow. The borrowing is entirely that of the federal government. And whatever revenues you transfer to provinces, they don't know anything else but to spend them. They don't accumulate, they don't have funds, etc. So with this revenue sharing, and either of the two things have to give in, either we revise the sharing arrangement or the federal government cuts its size down significantly. The two things cannot go on. Yeah. So that again is one thing that I feel is a remains a source of instability in this whole equation.
Right. Mm-hmm. Okay. Thank you very much. Now, I mean, clearly we have a very complex social contract, and it is one that has not allowed us to discipline the government to stay within its bounds. So the government mismanages, it spills over, everybody gets affected, then the private sector gets affected. And it's because the private sector gets affected that we end up going to the fund, because the private sector is unable to perform its function of exporting to the rest of the world, so that the reserves crisis, the balance of payments crisis, which is what really forces us to go to the fund, can be avoided. Is there anything in the budget, or is there anything in ongoing thinking of the government, including, let me take this opportunity to make a plug for the report that was prepared by the Economic Advisory Council, which has large chapters on both structural reform in the revenue and expenditure area, but also importantly, structural reform for greater competitiveness of the economy. Is there anything that we see in this budget and other pieces of policy work that's going on in the government to give us confidence that the private sector will be allowed to play its role, to allow the government to make its mistakes because of the social contract and yet not end up with an empty kitty and the need for going to the fund, as it happens in many other countries? So, Naveen?
I think just want to mention that what I see as the underlying problems where we are today, these are, I think, one was a chronically overvalued exchange. We've run this for a very long time, and it has had a tremendous impact on the structure of the economy. So therefore, we discourage investment in tradable sectors, we discourage exports, we encourage imports, and that's one thing. I think that if the institutional reforms of the state bank, which they have promised to make that independent and the exchange rate to be market-based, then I think we would have maybe permanently addressed this issue of chronic overvaluation exchange rate. And if we do so, then long-term benefits of it can be tremendous. To the other point, I just want to mention that I have just attended two meetings of the MPC. Pasha was on it for 3 years. But my experience has been that at no time was it ever mentioned whether the IMF wants you to raise to 12% or 12.5% or whatever. Basically, and I think I can say this because Raza mentioned it in his speech, that the target is a 2 to 3% real positive exchange rate. Interest rate. And that is based on what the estimate of inflation is going to be in the next 2 months. So if the inflation next 2 months is going to be 9%, then the rate would be 12%, round about there. And if it next meeting, if it happens to be 11%, the rate might go up to 13% or 14%. If it remains the same, the rate would not change. So I think it is a myth that the idea is that IMF is dictating the interest rate that is to be set. The exchange rate also is made very clear in his presentation that the exchange rate has to be one which we can sustain. We cannot afford to borrow money and finance it. Therefore, when we say market-based exchange rate, we really mean an exchange rate which is sustainable. If we expect a couple of billion dollars or more every year in addition to our trade and those current account, then we can run a deficit of $2-3 billion on the current account. But it has to be sustainable. So this is the policy, and I think that unless exports can increase dramatically, it may put further pressure on the exchange rate. I think this institutional reform, if it is sustained, would be very, very significant. The other institutional reform is the one that I referred to. I really think in this economy, there's no level playing field. I don't think real estate, I don't think retailing, I don't think this distribution, any of this can add to competitiveness and growth in this economy. So the budget, by trying to bring everybody into the tax net, hopes to level this playing field. And if they are successful, which is a big if I mention, then investment will be diverted from current speculating on the real estate and other activities into more productive activities. And if that does happen, it should add to productivity growth, competitiveness growth, and growth of the economy. So from those two sides, I think that I do see some steps. The first time I do see steps which could resolve the structural issues there are. As I said earlier, implementation is the big if. And the second big
risk is that for us to grow, we need to have investment. And will people be willing to invest under this current environment of low growth, high interest rates? And what policies is the government implementing to ensure that there is incentive for people to invest? Without investment, there is not going to be anything. Now, Pasha mentioned, I hadn't looked at the numbers, but Pasha mentioned that 400 billion rupees have been kept for poverty alleviation. If a large chunk of that is for a near housing scheme, or is that a separate, is it?
Separate.
That's separate. So I think that in that, there may be potential for in the first year or two, having some programs which are poverty oriented, which may provide impetus to the economy and to growth. So I think these are the main risks as far as I'm concerned, that really it doesn't matter whether we collect 5.5 trillion or whether we collect 5.1 trillion. There's number games, it's not important. Important thing is, can we provide export refunds, a sales tax refund to the exporters in a timely manner? Can we tax everybody else fairly? And those, if we can do, I think that these reforms that are being done could be remembered as the Manmohan Singh reforms in the 90s, which were the watershed moment for India. These could be that. I'm not saying they will be, because as I mentioned, there are a number of risks involved. And but still, this is the first time I feel that there are steps being taken which don't deal only with the symptoms. The symptom is a fiscal deficit, so to reduce the fiscal, you cut expenditures, and you put in withholding taxes, and you do this, and you close the deficit. Current account deficit, then you do the exchange rate and adjustment, and then you put import duty, then you... So this is being also addressing the structural problem, I think. So to answer your question, I think that there is hope, but the next year will tell.
Okay, so we've had... I want to open it up for discussion.
Can I just make one or two comments, please, if I may?
Okay, very but quickly. Very quickly.
You see, some or the other one gets the sense that while what Naveed says is appropriate, there are certain steps which are taken in this budget which perhaps we could have avoided. The first is this move towards withdrawing the tax credit we used to give for balancing modernization and replacement. And this is at a time when Pakistan desperately needs to, including our textile sector and others, to modernize and become more competitive. I mean, it's not clear what the motivation was. Clearly, FBR only thinks about revenue and not how that impacts on the economy. The other inexplicable move is the reduction in the initial depreciation allowance also for investment. Why at this time? And the third, which not many people, including businessmen, have realized, I hope you have, Chairman of the Lahore Chamber, your energy inputs into the zero rating scheme are no longer refundable. Do you realize this? Do you know what that means? Okay. I'll stop here. This is not a pro-export budget. Full stop.
Okay. So we had we divided up the discussion into three parts. There was consensus that there was no alternative to going to the fund. We had to do it. We should have done it a lot sooner than we did. The second part, there were different views. Hafiz didn't think it was a credible budget because he didn't see the overall fiscal deficit coming down because of the interest rates. Whereas Waqar gave us convincing arguments that it is a credible instrument for stabilization. On the third component, by and large, I detect optimism that yes, there have been good steps taken to restore competitiveness. The exchange rate was a big step. I remember a year ago, you couldn't touch the exchange rate. The last time a sensible governor of the state bank tried to do something about the exchange rate, he lasted about 2 weeks. So we've moved since then. However, there are some aspects in the budget where FBR, true to its form, has gone after the revenue objective and not competitiveness objective. For example, zero rating is consistent with the overall approach of removing exemptions, but then they should say what the credible mechanism will be for not charging exporters taxes which will raise the cost of their production. We haven't seen that credible alternative being presented. So it's a bit of a mixed story. I want to end with one very quick input from this panel. You know, in all my years of working on different countries in the process of structural adjustment and similar crises, countries have always found it very useful to develop a counter narrative while they are undertaking tough stabilization. They start talking about the world as it will be after we have gone through the hardship. During the East Asia crisis, Korea, Thailand, Malaysia, they had developed counter-narratives. And there was a big messaging on the counter-narratives to convince people that, look, these are hard times, but then soon it'll be a good world. If you were the finance minister, what counter-narrative would you propose?
Actually, I will be very honest with you. I prefer to regret being one. Very recently, clearly because of health reasons, and I think some of us are at a point in our lives when we should hand over to younger and perhaps more competent people. The counter narrative that needs to be built, unfortunately, is something which in a way today will lack credibility with the people. You see, there has been such a great degree of disillusionment with the quality of governance, with what we have seen over the last, that people think this is a kind of an exercise in trying to con us. The real counter-narrative would have been if we had managed to lay out an explicit economic plan for the next 3 years, which we have not done, and made it a credible exercise whereby we could demonstrate that somehow that after this initial very heavy duty reform and painful adjustment, we would be able to move on to better times. This should have been accompanied by at least a 3 to 5 year macro and policy framework, which unfortunately this government has not done.
Okay.
I've been saying this thing, that this is a time in nation's life where we need some reconciliation, we need some lowering of the temperatures that have risen to a very high level. And I mentioned a while ago, this budget is needing an enormous amount of sacrifices. They have avoided in the tax policy not to broad brush things like general sales tax. They could have easily netted 200 billion rupees by increasing it by 1 or 2 percentage points, or raising the maximum corporate tax rate from 30 to 35, the regressive thing, and saying that, look, these are difficult times. They have avoided. So I think this is something that I have appreciated. But what I feel that there is no narrative. I feel that the whole economic team is shell shocked. They're living where this governor, and I have appreciated today in my Business Recorder article that he came and held that press conference. I lauded this effort and have written a very positive assessment of this thing. But look, I mean, this is when Mr. Asad Umar was there, we know that he is a master of caustic remarks and not of any tamiri khayalat bade kam aate hain unko, theek hai ji. To yahan par koi aaye jo guftugu kare, logon ko bataye ki janab, maine agar aap se qurbani ki darkhwast ki hai, main khud bhi qurbani de raha hu, mere sare saathi qurbani de rahe hain aur hum ye sab kuch kar rahe hain ki apni kal ko sanware. Aaj agar humne is cheez ke upar amal kiya sanjeedgi ke saath, nazm o zabt ke saath, to kal main dekh raha hu ki ek nayi subah hone wali hai jiske andar aasaniyan paida hongi, jiske andar sarmayakari ka amal shuru hoga, jisse growth hogi, jisse naukriyan paida hongi, rozgar paida. Aap mujhe bataye kahin par koi aapko aanke yahan khade nahi ho raha. Agar wo koi kisi qisam ki guftugu karte hain is mamle mein, to wo kehte hain hum to dusron ka bojh utha rahe hain. Yani abhi tak jo hai wo apne aap ko maazi se jode hue hain aur maazi ko kosna aur matlab usko bura bhala kehna jo hai usi mein ulje hue hain. Bhai zara nikle, kuch to logon ko jo hai ek dusra paigham bhi dein aur usme jo hai to meri guzarish ye hai ki ye nahi hai, ye hona chahiye tha. Abhi bhi bahut zarurat hai. Aaj tak Prime Minister ne is IMF program ke liye ek do tareefi kalmat Peshawar ke andar, ek bilkul isolated kisi function ke andar ada kiye. Uske alawa to wo nahi aaya kehne ke liye ki janab main matlab jo hu main iske piche khada hu aur isme. Bhai dekhiye, aaj to ek zara sa agar aap ijazat dein taaki main ek aur baat kehta chalu. Abhi ye Eid ke baad jo hai suna hai ek ijlas hua jiske andar puri economic team thi aur wazir azam sahab bade khafa the ki ye kya hua hai 157-158 aur ye to mere liye siyasi masla hai, ye hai. To shayad governor ne kaha, Afif Sheikh ne kaha ki aap kehte hain to hamare paas jo bhi reserve pade hain isse hum isko theek kar dete hain, lekin phir ye fund ka program wagaira khatam ho raha tha. Unhone kaha nahi, aap zarur kare aur jaisa kar rahe hain isi raste pe chalte rahe. Acha, is waqt jo hai aapke paas, dekhiye, this resolve will be tested repeatedly. It is not a one-off thing. आज तो मतलब ये नहीं कि 11 महीने की एक खता है जिसकी आप मतलब जो है अजाला कर रहे हैं. अब वो कुछ दिनों के बाद आप कहेंगे यार ये मेरे ऊपर क्या बोझ डाला हुआ है. मतलब थोड़े से अरसे के बाद मुशर्रफ साहब ने भी कहा शौकत जी से, यार आई हैव बिटन इनफ बुलेट्स, कुछ और करो, कुछ और चीज बताओ, ये नहीं करूँगा मैं. तो ये जो अगर जज्बा है, अगर इस्लाह की आपके अंदर इस वक्त कोई तहरीक है, तो इसको भी नर्चर करना है, इसको कायम रखना है ताकि ये ख़त्म हो. सॉरी,
सही बात. थैंक यू वेरी मच. ये अच्छा नवेद, आपने चूंकि ऑलरेडी इस तरफ इशारा कर दिया था, बट वुड यू लाइक टू ऐड समथिंग कि व्हाट शुड बी.
वेल, आई थिंक बेसिकली बिल्कुल सही बात की है वकार साहब ने कि देयर इज नो नैरेटिव, बट दे कैन बी अ नैरेटिव. एंड आई थिंक दैट द नैरेटिव शुड टेक द शेप ऑफ व्हाट आई वॉज ट्राइंग टू से. And basically, I won't repeat myself, but the narrative underlies this, whether it is by design or whether koi by coincidence ho gaya. Shabbar ki apni thinking hai to wo beech mein aa gayi, Raza ki apni thinking wo beech mein aa gayi. Apna fees keh raha tha maine bada seekha hai pichle experience se, to ab maine wo galti nahi karni ke main फ्रंट लोडिंग ना करूं क्योंकि बाद में कुछ नहीं हो सकता. सो ही इज ब्रॉट दैट इन कि IMF ने कहा एक्स करो, ने उसने कहा एक्स प्लस टू करूंगा मैं, क्योंकि टू जो बाद में नहीं मेरे से होना. सो इन अ सेंस के वेदर इज जस्ट हैपन्स टू बी अ कोइंसिडेंस दैट दे हैव दिस थ्री पीपल इन देयर हु ब्रिंग दिस थिंग
onto the table, and collectively they have brought it, given you credible connection of policies. I think the issue jo Waqar sahab ne raise kiya ultimately yehi hai ki there are difficult days ahead, and in those difficult days political will tends to erode. To jab tak Prime Minister sahab ye khule nahi kahenge ki bhi main is program ki ye program hai, iski wajah ye hai aur main iske piche hu aur agle 2 saal aap log apni belt tight karke taiyar ho jaye. Until that does it, there will always be uncertainty whether at some stage he will get to the point where he says, mere se aur ye nahi khaye jate, ab bas karo. And that would be the end of it, because it will take at least 2 to 3 years for it to really begin to show dividends.
Thank you. Mere zehn mein government ke paas counter narrative ke liye ek bada acha document maujood hai. Us pe kaafi sare logon ne bahut sa kaam kiya hua. Economic Advisory Council ki report is called the roadmap, wo Ministry of Finance ki website pe hai. Usme structural reform ke tamam elements hain. Usko ek dilchasp storyline dene ki zarurat hai, ek political storyline dene ki zarurat hai. Wo government ka kaam hai, wo Economic Advisory Council ka kaam nahi tha. Lekin usko kisi wajah se, halanki Asad hamare dost the aur Asad was very nurturing of the Economic Advisory Council. Na Asad ne usko istemal kiya hai, na uske baad nahi team ne usko istemal kiya hai. Maine governor ko parson di thi wo report, maine kaha ki aap isko padh lein, isme aapka counter narrative banaye ki kai aapko raste mil jayenge, chahe wo social protection mein aap banate hain, chahe wo housing scheme ka counter narrative banate hain. I think the housing scheme idea is a very good one if it is thought through properly. या आप इसको कंपेटिटिवनेस को बेस बनाते हैं अपने काउंटर नैरेटिव को, या आप फेयरनेस इन टैक्स टैक्सेशन को अपना काउंटर नैरेटिव बनाते हैं, या आप गवर्नेंस रिफॉर्म विद इन गवर्नमेंट एक्सपेंडिचर लार्ज यूटिलिटीज़ को बनाते हैं काउंटर नैरेटिव. उस तमाम के जो फाउंडेशंस हैं वो आपको उस रिपोर्ट में मिल जाएंगे. उम्मीद है कि इस्तेमाल होगी और उससे गवर्नमेंट अपना काउंटर नैरेटिव बनाएगी. I think we've had a good discussion. Despite Naved's misgivings, I think the structure was a good one. Let me now open it up for questions. That's not a good question. It's open to questions.
Let Tariq sahab se shuru kare na, in sense ke he should give us his thinking on.
तो थैंक यू वेरी मच. बड़े अरसे के बाद ऐसे एक गैदरिंग में आया हूँ. 6-7 साल से तो मैंने भी रिटायरमेंट इख्तियार कर लिए, इस्लामाबाद से घबरा के जाता नहीं हूँ वहाँ पर. लेकिन जो आपने पैनल चुना था वो ऐसा था कि
माइक काम कर रहा
है, ऐसा पैनल था कि वो I couldn't resist or avoid coming here. 3-4 baatein purani hain, phir ek nayi hai baat, aur wo bhi actually nayi baat nahi hai, wo bhi purani baat hai. Pehli baat to government ke kharchon ki baat hui thi. Hafiz aapko yaad hoga, aapne aur maine ek shayad hum itni badi report banayi thi is sare mehkmo ki aur usko kaise karna hai. 1998 ki ye baat hai, during that second term of Nawaz Sharif. गालिबन वो अवेलेबल है अगर कोई उसे पढ़ना चाहे और करना चाहे इम्प्लीमेंट. इट्स ऑल्सो अगेन एन इशू ऑफ इम्प्लीमेंटेशन एंड पोलिटिकल विल. और वो तरमीम के बाद 18th के बाद तो बिल्कुल उसकी इम्प्लीमेंटेशन आसान हो जाती है, बिकॉज देयर इज लॉट ऑफ डुप्लीकेशन. वो जो सूबों के इख्तियार हैं वो अभी तक उधर भी फेडरेशन में भी चल रहे हैं, विच इज़ डबल एक्सपेंडिचर एन इनफिशेंसी उससे आती. दूसरी बात यह है जी कि आपने बड़ी पॉजिटिव पिक्चर नवेद साहब पे पेंट की है. ये एक्चुअली प्रोग्राम जो है ना रिफॉर्म प्रोग्राम ये पहले दो तीन औकात पे ये आए थे इसी तरह के, शायद इतनी तफसील से नहीं आए थे, लेकिन सर्टनली टैक्स की मद में और फॉरेन एक्सचेंज की पैरिटी के बारे में और रिफंड्स के बारे में और एक्सपोर्ट प्रमोशन के बारे में ये तीन दफ़ा आए, तीन दफ़ा ये इम्प्लीमेंट करने की कोशिश की गई और तीनों दफ़ा फेल हुए। मैं इसके ज़ाती तौर पे हक में हूँ, ऑल्दो मेरी जो बिज़नेस कम्युनिटी के मेरे जो कॉलीग्स हैं वो इससे बहुत ज़्यादा नाला हैं, लेकिन मेरे ख़्याल में इसके सिवा कोई और तरीका भी नहीं है। इसलिए कि अगर आप इसको वैल्यू चेन को इन वैट मोड नहीं इम्प्लीमेंट करेंगे तो ना आपकी डॉक्यूमेंटेशन होगी और ना आपकी स्पूरियस एक्सपोर्ट्स और स्पूरियस फर्म्स और ये सारा किस्सा जो चलता है। मगर मुझे व्हाट एम आई, हाउ एम आई टू बिलीव दैट दिस टाइम राउंड दिस रिफॉर्म प्रोग्राम विल बी इम्प्लीमेंटेड एंड दैट बिकॉज प्रीवियस forays into this have failed and miserably failed. और वो मैं समझता हूँ कि हमारी फर्मों में तो आठ आठ दस दस साल के रिबेट जो हैं या रिफंड वो अभी भी पड़े हुए हैं, इसलिए कि वो महकमा ये कहता है कि जनाब ये जिससे आपने जिसको आपने दिया था या जिससे कलेक्ट किया था वो एग्जिस्ट नहीं करती फर्म, और वो कोलूजन में सारा होता है। हाउ एम आई टू बिलीव दैट दिस टाइम राउंड दिस रिफॉर्म प्रोग्राम विल सी द लाइट ऑफ डे, दैट इज़ माई फियर। बट इन द मीन टाइम वॉट दिस इज़ लाइकली टू डू एंड दैट्स वेयर मेरे उस्ताद हफीज़ साहब पाशा की बात आ जाती है कि ये सारी जो इन दिस इंटरिम फेज ऑफ दिस सिस्टम बीइंग इम्प्लीमेंटेड फ्रॉम द 1st of July, इसमें हम कितनी रिसेशन या कितनी जो है बिजनेस एक्टिविटी को हम कर्टेल करेंगे, जिसका मुझे डर है। एंड फॉर द फर्स्ट टाइम एक्चुअली आई एम एक्चुअली फेयरिंग दैट सर्ट इन द डॉक्यूमेंटेड पार्ट ऑफ द इकोनॉमी विच मे बी 50% ऑफ द इंटायर पीस मे बी और मोर और लेस, आई डोंट नो, देर आर वेरियस एस्टिमेट्स, बट आई फील दैट वी मे एक्चुअली बी लुकिंग एट ए रिसेशन, वी एक्चुअली मे इन योर इकोनॉमिक जागन बी लुकिंग एट एक्चुअली नेगेटिव ग्रोथ एंड दैट कैन हैव डिजास्ट्रस रिपरकशंस। बाकी ये है जी कि the taste of the pudding is in the eating, I support it, और जिस सिम्त में ये लेके गए हैं बिल्कुल ये बातें पहले भी हुई हैं, by the way this is not thinking out of the box or anything like that, so let them not take credit कि जनाब हम पता नहीं आइंस्टाइन बन के तो आ गए हैं यहाँ। ये सारी चीज़ें हफीज़ ने भी प्लान की थी, सब ने प्लान की थी, डॉक्टर वकार को पता है कितनी दफ़ा, मुशरफ मेरे दोस्त ने भी ये इम्प्लीमेंट करने की कोशिश की थी, इट लास्टेड द होल ऑफ 8 weeks। वो क्या हुआ कि वो उन्होंने टीमें बनाई कि जनाब ये मेजर और कप्तान साथ जाएंगे एक्साइज के इंस्पेक्टर्स के, तो वो दो टीमें जो थी उनको उन्होंने काबू कर लिया यहाँ पे लिबर्टी मार्केट में, दे हेल्ड देम हॉस्टेज, और फिर 10 डिवीज़न के कमांडर को कहा गया कि भाई उनको जाकर रिहा कराओ, उन्होंने कहा जी मुझे कोई 100-200 आदमी मारने पड़ेंगे, उन्होंने कहा नहीं, फिर उनको कोई ख़त्म हो गया, तो 8 हफ्ते में वो ख़त्म हो गया। हाउ एम आई टू बिलीव कि ये ख़त्म नहीं हो जाएगा, ये डाइल्यूट नहीं हो जाएगा? इसको करने का तरीका मेरे हिसाब से ये था कि इसकी एंट्री लेवल 17% नहीं रखनी चाहिए थी, आई थिंक द बेटर अप्रोच वुड हैव बीन कि इसको 7-8% पे, इंग्लैंड में भी जब आया था ये 60s में तो हफीज साहब को याद है 6% था या 5% था, उस पर वैट आया था। वैट मोड इज़ अ वेरी कॉम्प्लिकेटेड थिंग टू इम्प्लीमेंट और इट हैज़ टू गो राइट फ्रॉम ए टू जेड थ्रू द चेन, इट इज़ द ओनली वे, इट इज़ नाउ द ग्रेटेस्ट द लार्जेस्ट अर्नर ऑफ रेवेन्यू फॉर द ब्रिटिश गवर्नमेंट, विच इज़ अ वेरी टैक्स कंप्लायंट नेशन, लेकिन वहाँ पर जो डायरेक्ट टैक्सेज हैं उसको इसने आउटस्ट्रिप कर दिया, VAT है ठीक, लेकिन क्या इससे एक्सपोर्ट्स बढ़ेंगी या घटेंगी? मैं समझता हूँ घटेंगी, इन द इनिशियल फेज घटेंगी, अनलेस वी कैन क्रिएट अ मिरेकुलस रिफॉर्म ऑफ द रेवेन्यू अथॉरिटीज एंड दैट इज़ ओनली पॉसिबल बाय यू नो ऑटोमेशन, बाय गेटिंग इनटू अ सिस्टम वेयर बाय देयर इज इलेक्ट्रॉनिक फाइलिंग एंड ऑल द रेस्ट ऑफ इट, एंड वी आर फार फ्रॉम देयर। ये तो उसी जो वो किसी ITO के नज़र जो है हो जाएगी ये चीज़, और ये इसको कितनी इसमें। अच्छा, दूसरी बात ये आपने इन्वेस्टमेंट की बात की, देखिए ना, इट्स एक्चुअली ये ट्रेचरी, आई कॉल इट ट्रेचरी। आपने एक इंसान को कहा कि भाई देखें आप इसको इन्वेस्टमेंट करें, और अगर इस डेट तक ये इन्वेस्टमेंट जो है ये प्रोडक्शन में आ जाएगी तो आपको टैक्स क्रेडिट मिलेगा। अब आपने उसको रेट्रोएक्टिवली रिमूव कर दिया। इट इज़ एक्चुअली डॉक्टर साहब रेट्रोएक्टिवली डन, रेट्रोएक्टिवली डन। तो आई हाउ कैन यू एक्चुअली देन टेल समबडी कि अच्छा भाई ये यहाँ पे माहौल ठीक होने वाला है, अब तुम इन्वेस्ट करो। और दिस शुड हैव बीन यू नो टेकन केयर। हाँ, आप कहते हैं हमने ये नहीं करना आगे से, आमदन यू नो फ्यूचर में ये नहीं होगी, फैसिलिटी अवेलेबल, करना है तो कर लो इन्वेस्टमेंट, नहीं करनी ना करो। बट इन द इमीडिएट फ्यूचर विच इज़ द 1 to 2 year टाइम फ्रेम या मीडियम टर्म में, आई डू नॉट एक्सपेक्ट एनी वर्थ वाइल इन्वेस्टमेंट टू टेक प्लेस इन कैपिटल। तो मैं इसको वाइंड अप करूँगा। मैं आई इंटायरली एग्री विद द रिफॉर्म प्रोसेस एंड विद द थिंकिंग बिहाइंड द रिफॉर्म। वट आई एम वेरी वेरी सस्पिशियस एंड वेरी डाउटफुल अबाउट इज देयर एबिलिटी टू एक्चुअली इम्प्लीमेंट।
यस,
दैट इज माई गोल।
लेट्स टेक अ फ्यू क्वेश्चन सो दैट द ऑडियंस एंड देन वी कैन रिस्पॉन्ड। Okay, let me take your question first.
I'm Ruksana Shah. I just wanted to ask that when you, Dr. Naved, talked about structural reforms, why are we not talking about reforming the entire economy? Because our economy is wrong. Like banking spreads are very high. The service sector has a lot of पैसे हैं, और जो मैन्युफैक्चरिंग सेक्टर है उनको बहुत ज़्यादा प्रॉब्लम्स हैं। हमारी इकॉनमी को ज़्यादा, बिकॉज वी हैव सो सच अ लार्ज पॉपुलेशन एंड अनएम्प्लॉयमेंट, वी शुड बी फोकसिंग मोर ऑन मैन्युफैक्चरिंग, जो एक्सपोर्ट लेड ग्रोथ की जो सारी कहानी थी। अब हमारे यहाँ जो बैंकिंग सेक्टर है, दे फॉर देम इट्स लाइक अ गोल्ड माइन, यू नो दे स्प्रेड्स आर 7%। व्हाई इज द नो टॉक अबाउट रिफॉर्म्स ऑफ द रिफॉर्मिंग द बैंकिंग सेक्टर इटसेल्फ, बिकॉज 12%, 14% इंटरेस्ट रेट इज अनफीजिबल। भाई आप अपना स्प्रेड्स कम करें, वो खुद ही 10% से नीचे आ जाएगी।
ठीक ठीक, लेट मी टेक वन मोर क्वेश्चन।
टॉकिंग अबाउट वॉट वॉज मिसिंग फ्रॉम द बजट एंड वेन यू आर ऑल्सो टॉकिंग अबाउट द नैरेटिव, so frankly I'm a bit disappointed, as I belong to the generation which was growing in the 1990s, and one reason that we felt so confident about the future of Pakistan at that time was because there was a rigorous privatization and we could see a lot of people making investments in that. So I'm a bit surprised. I would like you to respond to that.
Thank you. So I think we'll come back. We'll have a second round. So one is the structural reform going to address the question of the manufacturing sector not delivering? The second was, why isn't privatization part of the narrative? So let's have a quick response.
Maybe aap ijazat dein to Urdu pe aa jaun, just isliye ki jab aadmi thakta hai to apni natural language pe aa jata hai. देखिए, बात यह है कि जिस तरह नवेद ने कहा, इस वक्त जो हमारा टैक्स का बर्डन है, तकरीबन 70% से ज़्यादा आपने हमारे मैन्युफैक्चरिंग और इंडस्ट्रियल सेक्टर पर डाला हुआ है, और हमारा माशाल्लाह जो ज़री शोबा है मुश्किल से 1 या 2%, और अब चूंकि सेल्स टैक्स सर्विसेज वगैरह की थोड़ी सी डेवलपमेंट हुई है तो बाकी वहाँ से आ रहा है। सबसे पहले तो ये चीज़ है कि हमें अपने टैक्स बर्डन को फैलाना है, और यकीनन इस मर्तबा एक तरह से कोशिश की जा रही है, आगाज़ है, ख़ास तौर पे ट्रेडिंग सेक्टर पे। एक डेफिनेट मैं समझता हूँ कि इशारा इस बात पे कि 3-4 इकदाम लिए गए हैं जिससे यकीनन शायद हम ट्रेडिंग सेक्टर की तरफ जा पाएँ। बैंकिंग सेक्टर पर भी कुछ इकदाम प्रपोज किए गए हैं, और आपने बिल्कुल ठीक फरमाया कि द स्प्रेड्स हैव टू कम डाउन। और इस वक्त जो असल चैलेंज है कि गवर्नमेंट ने कहा है कि हम स्टेट बैंक से 1 पैसा बोरो नहीं करेंगे, इस साल उन्होंने सिर्फ 2.8 trillion रुपीस बोरो किए हैं और पिछले 70 साल में हम तकरीबन 3 trillion बोरो कर चुके थे. तो माशाल्लाह इस गवर्नमेंट की देखिए कामयाबी कितनी है.
4 trillion
तो अब कम हो गया ना, जब भी जो सेल किया है. मैं तो लेटेस्ट फिगर 5 तक पहुंचे थे. तो बात यह है कि इस हुकूमत की देखिए कारकर्दगी माशाल्लाह इतनी अच्छी है कि बेशुमार, मैं तो किसी से कह रहा था कि शायद 6 शिफ्ट पे ऑपरेट कर रहा था प्रिंटिंग कॉरपोरेशन ऑफ पाकिस्तान, 3 नहीं 6. तो लिहाजा द फंडामेंटल क्वेश्चन इज यू हैव टू हैव अ मच फेयरर सेक्टोरल डिस्ट्रीब्यूशन ऑफ द टैक्स बर्डन. दूसरी तरफ आपने जो प्राइवेटाइजेशन की बात की है, देखिए प्राइवेटाइजेशन का जिक्र है इस बजट में और बजट स्पीच में उन्होंने इशारा एक चीज पर डेफिनेटली किया है और वो है पंजाब में जो एलएनजी पावर प्लांट्स लगे हैं उस पर उन्होंने कहा है कि हम जल्द से जल्द उनको प्राइवेटाइज करेंगे और इंशाल्लाह उससे हम $2 billion हासिल करेंगे. अलबत्ता जिस तरह मैं कह रहा हूं कि कम से कम 2-3 साल का विजन दे देते कि हम प्राइवेटाइज, फॉर बिग इश्यूज आर विथ रिगार्ड टू स्टील मिल फॉर एग्जांपल, उस पर कोई क्लैरिटी नहीं है. और आपके बेशुमार छोटे से इदारे ऐसे हैं जिसको आप बहुत जल्दी से कर सकते हैं. और एक बहुत बहुत बड़ा इशू है, व्हाट शुड वी डू विद द डिस्कोस. आई डोंट मीन द म्यूजिक डिस्कोस बट द इलेक्ट्रिसिटी डिस्कोस. उस पर क्या पोजिशन है आपकी कि आप उसको प्राइवेटाइज की तरफ जाएंगे या नहीं जाएंगे. तो थोड़ा सा जिक्र है, ज्यादा होना चाहिए था.
बजट भी कर दिया है. Yeah, I mean, we have budgeted $150 billion on the financing side.
Yes.
आप कोई खास बात
नहीं, मैं कहना लगा था कि आप इन दो इश्यूज को जल्दी से अगर एड्रेस
कर. मैं कह रहा हूँ कि ये क्योंकि वक्त कम है इस वजह से ये बात नहीं हुई, वरना प्राइवेटाइजेशन तो इस प्रोग्राम की कामयाबी के लिए नागुजीर और मतलब यानी कि एक उम्मीद पैदा हो चली है. क्योंकि असद उमर साहब जो हैं उनका जहन तो मुंतशिर था इस मामले में. हफीज जो हैं उनका तजर्बा भी है, माजी में ये कर भी चुके हैं. और अभी 2 दिन पहले जो पहला इजलास हुआ है CCOP का, तो उसमें उन्होंने बहुत खफगी का इजहार भी किया है कि भई ये वहाँ पर एक कमेटी बनी रिस्ट्रक्चरिंग वाली, उन्होंने कहा 3 साल तक हम इनकी इसलाह करेंगे फिर सोचेंगे.
असल में आई थिंक ये बात आपने जो कही, आई जस्ट वॉन्ट टू मैंशन जो डिस्कस नहीं हुआ, गवर्नमेंट इज इंट्रोड्यूस व्हाट वी कॉल अ सिंगल ट्रेजरी अकाउंट. इस वक्त 1.6 ट्रिलियन रुपीस गवर्नमेंट के कमर्शियल बैंक्स में पड़े हैं. नाउ द रिक्वायरमेंट इज टू मूव देम ऑल इनटू द स्टेट बैंक. सो जो आप कह रहे हैं ना 2 कितने ट्रिलियन रुपीस हम बोरो कर चुके हैं, अ लार्ज पार्ट ऑफ दैट विल बी एडजस्टेड अगेंस्ट दिस सिंगल ट्रेजरी अकाउंट. बाकी प्राइवेटाइजेशन आई थिंक देयर हैज बीन अ कॉन्फ्लिक्ट. द प्राइम मिनिस्टर एंड असद उमर एंड दोज लॉट वर गिविंग अ मैसेज नहीं करनी, बट दैट नाउ द न्यू टीम बिकॉज ऑफ एक्सपीरियंस एंड हैज क्लियरली इंडिकेटेड के वी आर गोइंग टू मूव वे बियॉन्ड द 2 LNG प्लांट्स. वो जो आपने पढ़ा है वो उन्होंने काफ़ी झाड़ा उनको कि आप लेके आए. सो आई थिंक के यूर एप्टी राइट, प्राइवेटाइजेशन के बगैर सोल्यूशन नहीं है एंड वी शुड सी मच मोर ऑफ इट.
और मैं समझता हूँ कि प्राइवेटाइजेशन को ना सिर्फ इस प्रिज्म से देखना चाहिए कि उससे हम कितना डेट रिटायर कर लेंगे या कितना एक्सपेंडिचर
एफिशिएंट
कर लेंगे. इट शुड बी दैट वी हैव इम्प्रूव द क्वालिटी ऑफ सर्विसेज विच विल इम्प्रूव प्रोडक्टिविटी ऑफ द इकोनॉमी. There is no reason why PIA should be giving us this kind of service or our discos should be giving us this kind of service. So, ye usko ye angle bahut zaruri hai privatization ka, ki you should expect to improvement in economic performance. Okay, let's take the second round. Aapka haath.
Okay, so I have a question about the recent formation of the National Development Council, I believe, or the Commission.
Yes.
I just want to ask, what kind of space do you foresee this occupying, especially with respect to this team, the State Bank Governor, the FPR, and the Finance Minister, and the implementation of the reforms, and I guess the kind of trajectory that we're headed on.
Yeah, please.
See, my point was that although it was touched upon government came, there was a lot of talk about exports and particularly import substitution.
Yes.
And with the challenge that we have on the trade deficit, if any one of you would like to comment, if there is anything in this budget for this, and if not, what is the way forward in terms of enhancing exports and reducing imports?
Okay, thank you. Ed, please.
There are a question with reference to the economic narrative. Import substitution, in particular, civil military collective efforts for engineering equipment. Shayad usme is waqt sabse badi space hai, jo hum $4 to $6 billion. Ho sakta hai, nahi ho sakta hai, hoega, nahi hoega. Second counter narrative mein, having a national growth strategy, self-reliance agenda, jo bhi humara underutilized potential hai, HR mein ya small, medium mein, uske upar hum, can we come out with something?
Okay. Please.
Deeply share kiya hamare saath. Crisis, a very severe crisis, as something that would make reforms palatable. Ek thinking, wo hai thinking literature mein, you have to reach a level of deterioration, a level which will shock and awe people to such a degree ki ye jo itne saalon se hum reform करने की कोशिश कर रहे हैं और नहीं कर पा रहे हैं, हम सारे इस प्रोसेस में एंगेज रहे हैं इन डिफरेंट लेवल्स, वो क्या ऐसी थ्योरी वो एग्जिस्ट करती है, इसकी क्या हमें इससे और भी नीचे जाना बिफोर वी कैन रीच दैट पॉइंट. वो कहते हैं कि जब इंडिया में वो रिफॉर्म्स आई, आई थिंक 91-92 में, तो उनके रिजर्व्स जो थे ऑलमोस्ट क्लोज टू ज़ीरो. हाँ, गोल्ड भी चला गया था,
नहीं गोल्ड दिया,
बेच दिया था,
गोल्ड भी बेच दिया. तो इस लेवल पे पहुँचे तो उनको फिर मनमोहन सिंह को लाना पड़ा, बिकॉज देयर पॉलिटिकल क्लास वाज नॉट अप टू, कुड नॉट स्टेप अप टू द चैलेंज दैट वाज नीडेड. सो दे फाउंड मिस्टर मनमोहन सिंह. परहैप्स हमारे पास भी कोई मनमोहन सिंह जैसा कोई, मैं आई एम जस्ट रेजिंग दीज थॉट्स, आप थोड़ा सा एक इस पर रिफ्लेक्ट करें. इज समथिंग लाइक दैट ऑल्सो हैपेंड इन टर्की?
Yes.
Something maybe not approaching that level of deterioration, but they went into an IMF program, and then the IMF program was a very tough program, and then there was the political, something happened in the political culture, and then they delivered.
Right.
And they are now reaping the fruits of that,
right,
of what they did.
Right.
Is kism ka process, some thoughts on, is this process underway in Pakistan? Then where we are now, to get to see that narrative.
Yes.
Well, narrative ke liye bhi relevant hai mera.
Because so we've had four types of questions. Ek to ye hai ki with this National Development Council, is this too many chiefs and not enough braves? Who's going to do the thinking for these guys to preside over? Then there's a question about exports and import substitution. More on import substitution, and finally, do we need to suffer more before we start doing the sensible things? Who is the Messiah? Huh? Who is the Messiah? आप कीजिए.
जी, National Development Council का जिक्र हुआ है. आप अगर उसे देखें और कंपेयर करें, जो हमारे आईन में एक काउंसिल मौजूद है जिसका नाम है नेशनल इकोनॉमिक काउंसिल, एक नुमाया फर्क नजर आएगा आपको कि इस नए डेवलपमेंट काउंसिल में एक शख्स बड़ी अहमियत के ऐड किए गए हैं, और वो हैं आर्मी चीफ ऑफ स्टाफ. तो यह इसका एक कुछ इशारा इस बात पे है कि सिविल मिलिट्री want to cooperate, get together, and perhaps work jointly towards resolution of the kind of reform agenda, implementation, and so on. And also keep a lookout for this so-called IMF types and so on. So, ये मेरे ख्याल से इसका मकसद यही है. हालांकि उसमें to justify it even more, उन्होंने regional connectivity वगैरह की बात की, वो तो National Economic Council भी देख सकता था. तो ये शायद वजह है. आपने इम्पोर्ट सब्स्टिट्यूशन की बात की और एक्सपोर्ट्स की बात की. इम्पोर्ट सब्स्टिट्यूशन की तरफ मैं आ जाता हूँ. جس طرح نوید نے پہلے کہا تھا کہ ایکسچینج ریٹ جب آپ نے آرٹیفیشلی اوور ویلیو رکھا ایک وقت ایسا تھا کہ یہ تقریباً 27% اوور ویلیو تھا تو یقیناً امپورٹس ہیڈ بیکم ویری چیپ اینڈ وی ور بیکمنگ اے کائنڈ آف اے ٹریڈنگ نیشن اب یقیناً ایکسچینج ریٹ کے پراپر ایڈجسٹمنٹ کے بعد آپ دیکھ رہے ہیں کہ امپورٹس میں کچھ کمی آئی ہے والیوم میں کمی آئی دوسری طرف اس بجٹ میں مجھے ایک دو چیزیں اچھی لگیں بجٹ کے بارے میں امپورٹ سبسٹیٹیوشن کے لحاظ سے انہوں نے پہلی دفعہ ٹیرفز کی کیسکیڈنگ جو ہے اس پہ زور دیا ہے اور کوشش یہ کی ہے کہ ہماری جو امپورٹ سبسٹیٹیوٹنگ انڈسٹری ہے اس کو کچھ بہتر پروٹیکشن ملے بسائڈز دی ایکسچینج ریٹ اور وہ یہ کیا ہے انہوں نے کہ 1700-1600 آئٹم پہ را مٹیریلز اور انٹرمیڈیٹ گوڈس پر ڈیوٹی معاف کر دی ہے ڈیوٹی ختم کر دی ہے جو کہ ایک مناسب اسٹیپ ہے بیکاز اٹ گوز انٹو ایکسپورٹس اینڈ سو آن دوسرا انہوں نے جو آپ کے ہائر سلیبس ہیں جو 16% کا سلیب ہے وہ اب 20% ہوگا اور جو ہائیسٹ سلیب ہے آپ کا جو 20% تھا وہ اب 27% ہوگا تو اسپریڈ جو ہے کیسکیڈنگ جو ہے اس میں کچھ اضافہ ہوا ہے اور میرے ایک دوست اسٹوڈنٹس نے کیلکولیٹ کیا اسے سگنیفیکنٹ امپیکٹ ہے آن سب کی امپورٹ سبسٹیٹیوٹنگ انڈسٹریز ایکسپورٹس پہ مجھے افسوس سے کہنا پڑتا ہے پھر سے کہ مجھے اس طرح کی تھنکنگ نظر نہیں آئی ہے اور آخری جو آپ نے بات کی نیریٹو کی آپ اجازت دیں تو میں ایک دو پرانی باتیں جلدی سے کہہ دیتا ہوں
ایک کہہ دیتا ہوں
چلیے اور وہ یہ کہ 3 مہینے دا ڈینز آف دا پرائیویٹ سیکٹر مائی سیلف اینڈ 4 other ministers وی پریپیئرڈ این ایجنڈا فار ریشنلائزیشن آف دا فیڈرل گورنمنٹ جس کا آپ نے ذکر کیا بڑی محنت کیجیے ہم نے انوینچولی وی کیم ڈاؤن ٹو پھر ممبر 16 ministries اینڈ سو آن سو فورتھ یس ہاں And, sorry, including the attached stuff, at best about 16.
Down from 48
ke kharib thi. In fact, it was close to 52, if I remember correctly. Achha, ab ye hai, ye itni mehnat ke baad, Prime Minister sahab ko to pasand aayi, hamare jo us waqt ke Prime Minister the, he liked small government. You know, he was basically a private sector man. He liked see the more actions by the private sector. That's why we did it. اچھا آپ کو شاید اندازہ نہیں ہے کہ کابینٹ میں کیا ہوا ہم لے کے گئے رپورٹ پیش کی جلدی سے پیش کی ستار صاحب تھے فائنینس میں پلاننگ کا وہ تھا ڈپٹی چیئرمین جیسے میں نے ختم کیا ایک ہاتھ اٹھا سر کیا میری منسٹری رہے گی یا نہیں رہے گی پھر شیخ رشید صاحب نے دعادار تقریر ماری کہ سر ہم تو الیکٹ ہو کے آئے ہیں آپ ہمیں ہٹا رہے ہیں یہ کیسے ہو سکتا ہے سر یہ کیا ہو رہا ہے یہ کہاں سے آگے آئی ایم ایف کا بندہ میں بھی آئی ایم ایف ڈکلیئر ہو چکا ہوں حالانکہ میں ایک دفعہ آئی ایم ایف میں کام نہیں کیا آپ تھے نا یار وہ جو ہم پہ حملہ ہوا ہے ان 10 minutes دا رپورٹ واز تھرون لٹرلی آؤٹ آف دا ونڈو کھانا منگوا یہ حال ہے ان ریفارم اس طرح آپ دیکھیں اس کا کیا حشر ہوتا ہے
اچھا یہ وقار یہ عشرت بھی تو بہت دیر سے رائٹ سائزنگ آف گورنمنٹ کی بات کر رہے ہیں سو اس حوالے سے اگر آپ ان کا سوال کا جواب دیں تو
اچھا ان کا سوال تو دوسرا ہے ذرا سا اس پہ پہلے میں آپ کی بات کروں دیکھیں مطلب یعنی کہ عشرت صاحب دو کام کر رہے تھے آسٹیریٹی کا بھی کر رہے تھے اور جو ہے گورننس وغیرہ جو ہے نا انسٹیٹیوشنل ریفارمس وغیرہ تو ابھی تک تو مطلب نہ صرف یہ کہ نظر نہیں آیا بلکہ ایک پرورس چیز سامنے آئی ہے کہ وہ ریٹائرمنٹ ایج 60 سے 63 سال کر دیں جس کی آج جو ہے بالآخر
تردید شائع ہو گئی ہے کہ نہیں فی الحال
نے تو کر دیا
جی سر
فرنٹیئر نے کر دیا
ہاں اب سر دیکھتے ہیں کہ مطلب وہاں پر بھی جو ہے یہ کیبنٹ نے کر دینے سے نہیں ہوتا وہ تو لا امینڈ کرنا ہے تو وہ کر سکتے ہیں وہاں لا امینڈ لیکن کچھ نہ کچھ یہ روکنے کا کر سکتے ہیں ورنہ بہت بڑا بگاڑ پیدا ہو جائے گا اچھا دیکھیں یہ بڑی اہم بات شجاعت صاحب پوچھ رہے ہیں کہ کیا ہمارے درمیان حالات اس قدر بگڑ گئے ہیں اتنی جسے کہتے ہیں صورتحال خراب ہو گئی ہے کہ لوگ ہر چیز کے لیے جو ہے وہ تیار ہوں گے جو بھی کوئی آپ تکلیف انہیں دینا چاہتے ہیں قربانی مانگنا چاہتے ہیں ایک تو میری گزارش ہے کہ دیکھیں خود ہندوستان اور پاکستان دونوں جگہ یہ کوئی ایک معاشرتی یا ایک ثقافتی ہے ہمارے ہاں پین بڑا محدود رہا ہے دیکھیں نا کوئی مطلب جس طریقے سے لیٹن امریکہ وغیرہ کے اندر یا اور جگہوں پر جو ہے نا خدا کا شکر ہے ٹھیک ہے جی کہ ہمیں اس طرح کا کیاوس وغیرہ دیکھنے کا نہ کبھی ماضی میں ہوا ہے گو کہ ڈسممبرمنٹ ہو گیا یہ ہو گیا جنگیں بھی ہماری ہو گئیں لیکن ہر دو ملکوں کے اندر یہ کوئی نہیں ہوا کہ بھائی بہت بڑا یعنی کہ دیکھیں آپ نے جیسا آپ کہا کہ منموہن والی بات جو ہے دیکھیں یعنی منموہن والی بات ہوئی ہے کیا ہوئی ہے بھائی منموہن والی بات یہ ہوئی ہے کہ ایک بڑے عرصے کے بعد نہرو کی فلسفی کے مخالف خود کانگریس نے ایک کام شروع کیا بی جے پی جو ہے اس نے اس کو جاری رکھا پھر دوبارہ یہ لوگ آ گئے انہیں اور دفعہ موقع ملا اور وہ جاری رہا ایک بڑا جوہری فرق ہے ان میں اور ہم میں اور آپ لوگ ذرا غور کیجیے گا مطلب وہ تقریباً اپنے جو اختلافات ہیں اس کو اس مقام پہ نہیں پہنچاتے جہاں پہ مطلب جو ہے آپ پھر اس کا خیال نہ کریں کہ اس کے نقصانات ملک کو کیا ہو رہے ہیں کیا نہیں ہو رہے ہیں لیکن آئی پی پیز ہوئے ٹھیک ہے جی تو انہوں نے کہا کہ جی یہ غلامی کے توق ہماری گردن میں ڈال دیے گئے ہیں تو آپ نے مطلب بیڑا غرق کر دیا مطلب جو ہے اس ساری چیز اس کے بعد آج تک نہیں آیا فورن بائی دی وے ٹھیک ہے نا جو فورن انویسٹمنٹ آیا تھا ہب کو لگا اس میں 44 انٹرنیشنل کمرشل بینکس کا کنسورشیم تھا جس نے اسے فنڈ کیا تھا اس کے بعد سے آج تک کبھی کچھ نہیں ہوا جو اگر ہوا ہے تو یہ سی پیک کا آیا تو اب چائنیز منی ہے اس کے علاوہ اب خود یہ دیکھیے اب اس کے بعد مطلب مشرف صاحب نے تو معافی بھی مانگی قوم سے کرنسی فریز کرنے پر بھی ایف سی وائز اور اس چیز کے اوپر اب جب سے یہ لوگ آئے ہیں دونوں یعنی پہلے تو پیپلز پارٹی اور یہ اب ایک تیسری قوت جو ہے وہ اس کو تحریب میں کھڑی ہے اور جھگڑا ہو رہا ہے اس دوران کے اندر ملک کا بے پناہ نقصان ہو رہا ہے اور اس کو اگر جس دن ہمیں خیال آ جائے نہیں کچھ لوگ نام دیتے ہیں اس کو کبھی آپس میں بیٹھ کر چارٹر آف اکانومی بنا لے چلیں جو نام دینا چاہیں دیں لیکن ایک یہ بات طے کر لیں کہ کچھ ملک کے مفادات ایسے ہیں جن سے ہم سب جو ہیں ان کو اٹھا کے اپنے اوپر رکھ دیں ہماری سیاست جو ہے وہ اس کو آن کے خراب نہ کرے اور ہم اس کا ہر لحاظ سے کریں گے کیا ہمارے اندر اتنی جسے کہتے ہیں بردباری ہے ہمارے اندر اتنی سمجھ ہے کہ ہم لوگ بیٹھ ہم تو یعنی دیکھیں نا ڈاکو اور چور کا ڈسکورس ہے اسٹینڈرڈ اور کیا ہے تو جب اگر ڈاکو اور چور والی بات ہوگی تو اس میں پھر گفتگو تو ہوتی نہیں کوئی اعتبار نہیں ہے کوئی کسی قسم کا جو ہے آپ کو دوسرے پر ٹرسٹ نہیں ہے تو یہ چیز چلتی رہے گی سر میں اسی لیے میں کہتا ہوں یہ جو ہے بال بار بار لڑکتی رہے گی ایک جگہ سے دوسری جگہ بجائے اس کے کہ کہیں جا کے اس کو قرار آ جائے جی
ہم نے کہا تھا کہ ایکسپورٹ کی بات ہوئی امپورٹ سبسٹیوشن کی بات ہوئی میرا خیال ہے کہ حفیظ نے امپورٹ سبسٹیوشن کے بارے میں بڑی ٹھیک بات بتائی ہے ایکسچینج ریٹ پلس ریڈکشن ان امپورٹ ڈیوٹی ان را مٹیریلز شوڈ گیو اے بوسٹ ٹو امپورٹ سبسٹیوشن ایکسپورٹس میں जो इस वक्त वर्ल्ड ट्रेड एनवायरनमेंट है वो इतनी अच्छी नहीं है और उसमें हमारे वॉल्यूम बढ़ रहे हैं लेकिन कीमतें गिर रही हैं एंड सो ऑन सो. ओनली होप इज कि ये जो FTA फेज टू साइन करके आए हैं चाइना के साथ, जिसमें वो कहते हैं 313 आइटम हैं और जिसमें होगा वो 1 जुलाई से अगर ऑपरेशन होता है एंड इफ देयर व्हाट देयर सेइंग कि $2-3 billion की एक्सपोर्ट्स का पोटेंशियल है विद इन 1 or 2 years. If you could get that, so that could create the impetus for growth, and it also could entice कि जो वहाँ manufacturers हैं garments के या दूसरे light engineering वगैरह के जो वहाँ जा रही हैं, अब उनके लिए wages बढ़ गए हैं वगैरह, वो यहाँ आके अपनी establish करें जो हम कहते हैं स्पेशल इकोनॉमिक जोन से और वहाँ करें. तो एक ये जो है दिस इज अगेन क्वेश्चन ऑफ इम्प्लीमेंटेशन, लेकिन इफ दे कैन डू इट दैट इज अ ह्यूज पॉसिबिलिटी. और तीसरा जो है ये अग्रीमेंट साइन किया हुआ है रियल टाइम पे इंफॉर्मेशन देंगे ऑफ इम्पोर्ट्स फ्रॉम चाइना की बिल ऑफ लेडिंग की
अंडर इनवॉइसिंग
अंडर, अगर वो अंडर इनवॉइसिंग ख़त्म कर लें तो उसका भी ट्रिमेंडस इम्पैक्ट होगा आपकी लोकल इंडस्ट्री. तो ये 2-3 चीज़ें हैं इन द एयर, लेट अस सी हाउ दे कम अबाउट, बट दे डू हैव पोटेंशियल.
ओके, सो आई थिंक वी हैव रन 25 मिनट्स ओवर टाइम. ओके, इफ देयर इज एनी वन पर्सन हु इज डाइंग टू आस्क अ
क्वेश्चन.
I know the question time is over, so I'll just make a quick comment. I endorse what Dr. Bakar said about Manmohan in India. I was in a seminar in Dubai and I went up to him and I said, look, how do you explain the success of the programs in India, which was started more or less about the same time that our first economic reform programs came up?
Exactly.
He made a very interesting observation. उन्होंने कहा कि देखिए जब हमने अपना प्रोग्राम शुरू किया था आई मस्ट कन्फेस दैट वी बोरोड क्वाइट अ बिट फ्रॉम द प्रोग्राम दैट यू पीपल हैड आल्सो ड्रॉन अप एट दैट टाइम. ही वाज मूविंग अवे फ्रॉम द हिंदू इकोनॉमी, बट द अदर कमेंट दैट ही मेड वाज मोर इम्पॉर्टेंट. कह रहे हमारे यहाँ जो डॉक्टर साहब भी कह रहे हैं इरिस्पेक्टिव ऑफ द चेंजेस इन द गवर्नमेंट सब्सिक्वेंटली ईच गवर्नमेंट परसिस्टेड विद दैट प्रोग्राम एंड कंटिन्यूटी विच इज़ वट इज़ इम्पॉर्टेंट हेयर. And as a parting thought, because the panel mentioned about कि अगले एक साल तक ये persist करते हैं या नहीं करते हैं, अगर तो जो economic reforms की आप बातें कर रहे हैं structural इसमें embedded हैं, तो then these should be continued not just beyond the next year, yes, but beyond the 5-year term of this government and thereafter as well. And since this was the last time that I get the mic and anybody else will, a parting thought for Naveed, who has access to Islamabad, कि अगर काउंटर नैरेटिव या एग्जिस्टिंग नैरेटिव को भी आपने पब्लिक डिस्कोर्स के लिए ले जाना है तो खान साहब से ये गुजारिश करें कि दोनों डबल एफ हु बीन रनिंग द मिनिस्ट्री ऑफ इंफॉर्मेशन फवाद चौधरी एंड फिरदौस आशिक अफगान को फारग कर दें. यू नीड अ बेटर फेस.
मेरा ख्याल है कि सबसे पहले आई मस्ट कॉम्प्लीमेंट ऑल 4 ऑफ यू आउटस्टैंडिंग इकॉनमिस्ट. यू कांट एग्री ऑन सर्टेन पॉइंट्स एज यूजुअल, दैट्स हाउ यू ऑल स्टार्टेड, सो दैट ओनली प्रूव्स दैट यू आर ऑल आउटस्टैंडिंग. आई थिंक सर यू नीड टू गेट अ फील ऑफ व्हाट्स हैपनिंग इन द मार्केट. ये ठीक है इंटेलेक्चुअल डिस्कशन इंटेलेक्चुअल डिबेट जो भी हो रही है बड़ी अच्छी बात है, एंड बिकॉज आई डोंट वॉन्ट टू टेक टू मच टाइम ओवर हियर. But I request that I invite all 4 of you to the chamber and invite everybody else over there and just give you a feel of what is happening in the market. Jo reality hai market ki, it's very very different from and I fear ke our GDP is going to shrink, our per capita income is going to shrink, the taxes that they think that they can get, I doubt if they will be able to achieve that. Hamari jo elasticity of export or import jo dono hai wo apni jagah pe rahenge. Jab hum kehte hain ki market based rate hoga dollar ka ya parity hogi, तो लेट्स वेट, मतलब 250 रुपये पर जाना है, 600 रुपये पर जाना है, 1000 रुपये पर जाना है, 2000 रुपये पर जाना है. नैन आई एम नॉट जोकिंग, बिकॉज अगर ये इतना काम करने के बावजूद ना हमारी एक्सपोर्ट बढ़ी है, इम्पोर्ट पे थोड़ा सा जो इफेक्ट आया है वो आपको भी पता है, मुझे भी पता है क्यों आया. ना हमने पेट्रोल कम किया, ना हमने मशीनरी कम की, मशीनरी थोड़ी बहुत कम हो गई, रॉ मटेरियल के बगैर इंडस्ट्री नहीं चलेगी, अगर फूड आइटम्स हमने रोकने हैं तो उसका क्या इम्पैक्ट होगा वगैरह वगैरह. जो है आई डाउट इफ वी विल बी एबल टू सस्टेन अ मैसिव सोशल इशू इफ वी डू नॉट कंटेन द प्राइस ऑफ डॉलर. So I think I should
price of dollar.
So I should invite all of you to the chamber, and I think we need a longer session than this small brief that I can say at this time. I'm very upset about the direction of this budget. It has no direction other than if they want to get more money.
Yes.
And they want to get more documentation. जो मेरा ट्रेडर मेरे पास आ रहे हैं जिनके ऊपर ये सारा बोझ डालना चाह रहे हैं, उनको रजिस्टर करना चाह रहे हैं, उनके NIC नंबर मांग रहे हैं, वो कहते हैं 2 साल के लिए बंद कर देंगे, काम क्या हो जाएगा. दे हैव दैट ऑप्शन, इंडस्ट्री के पास ये ऑप्शन नहीं है. वो दुकानदार है, वो कहता है ठीक है जी मैं नहीं करता हूँ. दूसरा ये है, वो कहता है मैं काम ही नहीं करता हूँ आपके साथ. देर इज ए होल सेट ऑफ स्मगलर्स एंड पीपल हु come from the tribal zones or Gilgit-Baltistan or from Balochistan or wherever, वो कहते हैं जी आपकी दुकान पर माल पहुँच जाएगा. तो आपकी दुकान पर माल पहुँच जाएगा, आप बेच लीजिएगा, वो जिसको बेचेगा उसके भी डॉक्यूमेंटेशन ही है. सो इन फैक्ट जो डॉक्यूमेंटेड इकॉनमी है वो ज़्यादा शायद आइसोलेट हो जाए एंड दे मे गेट इन टू ए मोर डिफिकल्ट सिचुएशन. सो कांट से मच एट दिस टाइम, but I need to give you a feel of what's happening in the market.
Thank you
sir.
Bilkul.
Thank you very much for an informed discussion. I want to talk about the narrative. However, before that, after hearing what I have just heard, it's pathetic that here we have sat and heard one version, but on the ground it's something different. As far as IMF is concerned, it's disposable income. As the way it has been treated by us, we've used it as disposable income. We've been 13 times for EFF, and I do not see that trend is going to change. But on the narrative, and I think it is very important that at this time we have a one of hope and an optimistic one, and we need the message which I would like to suggest is financial inclusivity. And there you have got a huge window of opportunity in the demographic transition, where you, and it is youth, and it's the youth bulge, and this government is talking about housing, education, vocational training, jobs, and getting out there, and that I think should be the narrative whilst we are wrestling with the chambers, with industry, with export, with import, and with the World Bank conditionalities. I think the message out to the common person is financial inclusivity. And I think that this is what the PTI government is trying to do, and covering the social protection also through the SRS program. Thank you.
Okay, so with that, let me thank the panel for the valuable time and their thoughts, etc. And now for thought correction, you have to go and see Elmas.